a quick but I know lively conversation with Jimmy Maymann. He is the executive vice president of AOL, and he is also president of ad content and consumer brands at AOL. So, Jimmy, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. For
we were on the phone with John last week talking about this conference and what he's hoping to accomplish. His focus is definitely on the future and how digital marketing technology can help marketers and content providers to navigate this ever-changing landscape, which I think the Verizon acquisition of AOL, that's the definition of changing the landscape.
Yep.
Very exciting. But our world now, it goes way, way beyond paid advertising. And so my first question is, what does your crystal ball tell you about what is, for most people, a blurry future? What will we see just in the year ahead and then to come?
That's a good question, and of course, if I had that crystal ball.
That crystal ball,
then,
I know, we all wish we did.
But at least from where I sit, one of the things that took further off in 15 and that we will see even accelerate in 16, I think, is that shift to mobile. And you know, when I talk about that shift to mobile, it has implications on everything, you know, how we create content, so from the inception of the idea, but also how we serve up the content, to how we monetize that content. What are the units, you know, how do we go about that? What role will video play both as a content vehicle but also as an advertising vehicle for mobile? I think, you know, that whole shift has challenged us in the way that that we think about our business. As I said, you know, our content creators now actually start with the mobile as the first place, you know, meaning that in the past when we created content, we would do it to the desktop. But actually we had to change that behavior, because if we're not changing that behavior, then we are also not really you know, leaning into this new screen that is obviously smaller. You know, and there's other things you can do with it, but you really have to start with that, because otherwise we're doing the same mistakes that happened when the shift came from print to digital.
Absolutely.
Where we tried to squeeze, mm-hmm. you know, the newspapers,
yeah,
or the magazines,
porting
that over to the desktop, when we saw kind of how that allowed a whole new line of businesses to come in there. And if we talk about one of the brands that we have in the portfolio, HuffPost, how HuffPost, mm-hmm. within the course of 10 years, were able to build one of the biggest news audiences in the world, mm-hmm. because the traditional players were doing it in the old school way. Mm-hmm. And I think that is where we're at this point. You know, I think when we look at mobile, the digital consumption, 2 out of 3 minutes that's consumed right now is consumed on the mobile. And obviously that should tell us that this is real. It is, you know, we are all now mobile first businesses. If we're not, then we're doing something wrong. And I think that is for me the biggest thing that happens and will continue to drive how we think about business in 16.
So staying just with the mobile conversation, I think you're absolutely right that the tendency is to kind of port over content in its same form, you know, from one channel or medium to the next. But I've always thought that's kind of disrespectful to the consumer, because the consumer doesn't come to mobile with the same expectation that she comes, you know, to television or to print, et cetera. But what is how are you thinking about user engagement? Because this is, of course, a very personal device, and we don't have a lot of experience with that. So how are you thinking about keeping the consumer engaged?
I think that's a very important thing to keep focus on in 16 as well, because another, you know, mega trend that's happening around us that's also changing the way we think about things is this whole off-network distribution, you know, distributed content. Mm-hmm. We've seen Snapchat Discover, we've seen Facebook Instant Articles, you know, which basically, you know, asks publishers to publish their content directly on their platform,
right.
Meaning that suddenly you are not in control, you don't have the data, and they control the experience and the monetization. So to your point, you know, then the engagement becomes really important for the people that still bookmark or search or end up on your owned and operated, because what you want is, of course, you want to make sure that the people that are arriving on your site, that you're serving up the right kind of content, you know, across the right device, the right point in time, so it's contextually relevant. And that's another area where technology becomes increasingly important. You know, so from our perspective, we acquired Gravity a couple of years ago, which is doing artificial intelligence around passive personalization. And for us, that becomes very important because it really matters. If we suddenly have 20% of our traffic that sits on Facebook
outside,
or on Snapchat,
yeah,
Discover, then the people that come to our site, we need to make sure that they're consuming more of the right content. And the thing is, across our portfolio, we publish more than 2,000 articles or videos every day. And that's more than enough. The problem is it's actually information overflow. There's too much, and unless we can tell that when Wenda arrives across our mobile or desktop or tablet, that and she's arriving on this article, then the next article should be this one, right? You know, rather than just having no thought behind how we're serving that up. And the problem is, of course, when you're not logged in, you cannot do the Amazon recommendation, right? Because, you know, people are not logged in. But that is exactly what passive personalization allows you to do. And, you know, so we spend a lot of time on that because that will allow us to do better recommendations, to have people stay longer, engage with our content, and in the end, obviously, create more impressions across our owned and operated, so we still have inventory to sell to the advertisers.
Well, I think, you know, on your owned and operated, the acquisition by Verizon of AOL, it gives you data that it's hard to argue that others have it,
yeah,
at that level of personal information, et cetera. That would seem to set a very high bar, that you can set a high bar for using that data, you know, for engagement, optimization. That does change the landscape for AOL considerably, that vast data trove.
I think that's right. Obviously, that's what we're betting on. And I think, to your point, you know, it really, if you think about it, you know, AOL is one of the players out there that's able to kind of have the full suite from the premium experience that could be a content, native advertising or branded content experience, all the way to a native ad unit or a display unit that we serve up in a programmatic way. Obviously, with the AOL on one platform that has all the data. So now it's also, you know, because of the Verizon acquisition and the Millennial Media acquisition, it's also the first, you know, cross-screen, you know, where we can actually look at attribution. We can obviously use the data to your point, drive better engagement, but also drive better monetization of the units we then have on those sites because they become more relevant.
Well, I think the attribution, particularly cross-screen attribution, is an area of such importance to certainly to the marketer. And we haven't necessarily, I think, done a great job in the industry on attribution. It's still one of the looming issues for marketers. How do you think this new opportunity with Verizon and your focus on mobile, what does that mean to attribution? What do you think that you can bring to the party from a solution standpoint?
No, I would hope that, you know, by, you know, adding that extra layer of data that we're getting not only from Millennial Media but also from Verizon, as you said, you know, by doing that, you know, we're going to have a much more sophisticated set of data that will allow us not only to drive, you know, better content experiences or advertising experience, but really to drive better business solutions and business experiences to the point where, because we will have data now, so, you know, if you think about how we've gone about, you know, programmatic and the premium side of things, you know, we've been a lot about creating awareness, not really driving people all the way through the funnel. I think what we will see now, because of the added layer of data, so to say, we will be able to sell solution that where we can actually take you all the way through and actually, you know, show and prove, you know, how it leads to increased sale. And obviously that is an exciting new frontier for us to explore.
So I kind of, my perception of the acquisition is that this puts AOL in a very different competitor set, a very different consideration set. I think some people would argue that you are now at the table with Google and Facebook. You know, obviously Google, the 800-pound gorilla, et cetera, you don't have, you know, all that they necessarily have. The three are different, but I sort of perceive it as where you're dining out now is a little bit different than where you were as AOL. So I would ask you, sort of, what does this coming together of these two companies, what should we expect, particularly in 2016 and beyond? What should we expect beyond what we talked about, you know, with leveraging that data?
I think you're right. I think, you know, in the industry we all play in right now, scale matters, data matters, mm-hmm. and obviously with Verizon, Millennial Media, but I also have to mention the partnership we struck with Microsoft.
Well, that you gained extraordinary users
extraordinary reach, yeah, right? We're now touching more than 700 million people on a global basis in 21 markets. So the scale is, you know, to your point, getting up there where there's not a lot of other people that have that kind of scale. So what are we going to do with that scale? I think, you know, we already talked about, you know, how we are doubling down on mobile. I think the other thing that we are seeing is across our network, you know, people are consuming more and more video. So that's an area where we're also doubling down in terms of the video we are creating, but also thinking about what are some of the new format that needs to, you know, come on the back of that. Mm-hmm. We don't, you know, we think as an industry we need more innovation when it comes to format, and hopefully, you know, AOL, you know, as one of the bigger players, can play a role of helping define new format. It's an area we did quite well on in the past, but then we got focused on other things. We did the devil units that IB took as a standard. We've done things in the past, and that's an area where we really feel that we need to get back there, because we need, you know, we need to see better monetization as the traffic is shifting from desktop to mobile. Right now, from a CPM perspective, the CPMs has not really followed, but I also think it's because we haven't done a great job of thinking about what are the new, you know, as you're shifting screen, what are the formats that we need in order to create, you know, that engagement that we want. Yes, we've seen in-screen, but I think we can all agree if you look at a banner on a mobile, you know, most of them are a little bit annoying, you know, so I think we have a job to do there, and hopefully we will also be able to play a role in shaping that and helping put that forward.
You know, I was so excited about what was known as the devil units, because it was really the first time, in my experience anyway, that we were celebrating the quality of the creative, and, you know, you allowed that to happen. And I think that it's a very important opportunity for you to take a leadership role in defining what does creativity look like in a mobile world, because we just don't, you know, we don't know. And there's a big difference between a desktop and a laptop.
Yes.
In terms of your perception of the information that's kind of coming at you, so.
No, I think that's exactly right, and I think that especially right now, a lot of publishers are talking about native advertising, about branded content, and I think, you know, that works really well on the desktop right now, but, you know, also if we just take, you know, that and move it, you know, onto the mobile, right? Yes, we've seen the in-stream units and some of them are working, but what are the other ways, you know, how do you translate that? Because I do think,
exactly.
I do think that is more, you know, if you think about it from an advertiser perspective, I do think that advertisers in general need to think more like publishers, you know, and brands needs to become publishers in the sense that they need to think much more about content. What is the kind of content we want out there to re-engage with the audience? Because, you know, a lot of what we're seeing, obviously, in traditional units is that you're not seeing the same kind of engagement. It's not being celebrated, you know, among the users the same way, right? You know, they want content, they want experiences. How do we layer that into the advertising that we want to tell and sell?
Yeah, thinking about the plethora of choice for the consumer in terms of all of the different channels and devices where they can consume content, it kind of blows your mind. And, you know, as head of content for this company, how do you think about the volume of the content versus the quality of the content? Because we are talking, as you said, about scale.
Yeah.
And so how do you think about that in your role as president of content?
No, I think, you know, it's very important to find a balance. You know, we talked about it a second ago. There's things that are moving off network into social media networks. And, you know, so I think, you know, the way we think about it is, you know, almost like we have a strategy for all the different channels. And there's, you know, you need scale for some of the channels in the sense that you need fast pacing. You know, if we talk about a HuffPost, for instance, you know, they need to have a very fast paced turnaround of content, but they also need the deep investigative content. We always said, when I was at HuffPost, said that, you know, people come for the Kardashians because that's what they come across at Facebook, but then they stay for the Obamas, right? Because that's when they end up on the site and you kind of serve up the broader pieces. So I think that balance is very important because, you know, traffic still matters, but quality also matters. So it's important to find a balance. It's not, you can, I think at this point in time, at least if you want scale, you cannot just go deep and have, you know, the deep quality pieces. You need to find the right balance.
And HuffPo is such a great, great example of a company that really did do that. And you know, the winds weren't always favorable for its success. And I don't know all of the statistics on HuffPo, but it is pretty stunning how that has grown, not only in terms of volume, but importance in the whole news category.
Yeah, and I think that's, it's really because if you think about it, you know, HuffPost leaned into the trends that were there, right? You know, they leaned into search very early on. They leaned into social understanding.
That's right.
What are the things that works across social? So again, to my point about, you know, it's really about, you know, the different formats, but also the different channels. You know, what is it that we are serving up? So, you know, if you take HuffPost or TechCrunch, on Engadget across our portfolio, the way we think about the different channels is very different. You know, a story you will see on Twitter will be more news driven. You know, a story you will see on Facebook will be more lifestyle driven. And you know, that is kind of the
really understanding.
It's really understanding what is it that the audience is catering to, what is it that they want when they come to those specific channels. And of course, also the same as I talked about before, when they come to our own and operated directly, you know, what is it we're serving up? What is the entry point, and how do we get them deeper into the rest of it? I think that is really my key point, is how do we get them deeper into the content? How do we get them to stay and consume more? That will add value for us as a publisher, obviously.
So I think about a third of your users are viewing video when they visit your platform. I think that's probably a quite different figure than it was 2 years ago.
Oh, yes, yes.
Made a lot of investment there. So on your own brands, on a HuffPo and a TechCrunch, et cetera, how are you thinking about creating short-form original programming? I know you've done a lot in the last few years across the AOL.
Yes.
Spectrum on original programming, but you know, within the different O&Os that you have, how do you think about original programming? Because if you think about the extraordinary resurgence of content that's so appealing to the public, and all of the different, you know, whether it's an Amazon or a Netflix, on those O&O properties, how do you think about original programming?
You know, it's one of the things that we've done in the past is, you know, just think about what would be great content, and then, you know, obviously try to attract talent and create great webisode or series, and we've been quite successful doing that, in the sense that we just in 15 we had 3 Emmy nominations for our content. So even though it's a new discipline for us, something that we've built out over the last couple of years, we've kind of like found a way and found a voice and a way of doing it. What I will say that we are trying to do more of in 16, though, is doubling down on it, but really, you know, making sure that as we create those series, that content, that it kind of resonates with our existing audience, right? So, you know, either that it kind of, you know, we create a series, it needs to kind of then resonate to our tech audience on a TechCrunch, or, you know, so, because in the past we have developed content that was great overall, but not necessarily resonating and being specific enough for the challenges that we have. And I think that is one of the things that we're focusing on. We've been also focusing on, you know, if you take a HuffPost, you know, how do we bring that to life on a Go90, the OTT mobile video platform that we're launching? You know, how do you, you know, do we create a news channel for the millennial audience? The same with TechCrunch, and what's the life that they should have there? So video is front and center, and it's, you know, at the end of the day, it's what our user, our audience wants, right? You know, they want more video, and we need to kind of move from being a traditional text-based publisher to really embracing this. And, you know, as you said, right now it's around a third of our consumption is with video. I'm sure end of the year is probably more like 50% because it's growing so fast. So we obviously need to make sure that we have the resources and we are focusing on the things that can deliver that so they don't go somewhere else to get that content.
Well, we'll be watching with great excitement. Believe it or not, our 20 minutes are up. Could talk to Jimmy all day. But we will be watching, and we wish you and all your colleagues the greatest success.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you for having me.